Multimodal ultra-wide field imaging, the gold standard for retinal evaluation. In 2020, ultra-wide field imaging is the standard of care for imaging of the retina. That includes vascular and non-vascular disorders. In my clinic, all patients receive an optose image. This is for diagnosis, documentation, and determination of progression or response. It helps me educate the patient and their families. It increases my efficiency in the clinic, and it also helps with patient satisfaction. Part 1, defining ultra-wide field imaging. Last year, a group of us got together as the International Wide Field Imaging Study Group, where we outlined the classification and the guideline for wide field imaging. We determined that wide field includes images depicting retinal anatomy beyond the posterior pole, but posterior to the vortex vein ampullas. Ultra-wide field, on the other hand, includes images showing retinal anatomy anterior to the vortex vein in all four quadrants. Here are some examples. If you look at posterior pole imaging, it represents approximately 50 degrees of the retina. Mid-periphery is around 60 to 100 degrees, and it represents wide field imaging. Far periphery would be approximately 110 to 220 degrees, representing ultra-wide field imaging. You can see here both in the color fundus as well as the ICG, the location of the vortex veins. When we think about ultra-wide field imaging, we think about color imaging, ICG, fluorescein angiography, as well as OCT. You can see here that composite images may be able to make up ultra-wide field imaging, but of course the ease of use with one single shot capture may be preferable. Here's a comparison of the traditional seven standard fields when overlaid on the optose OptiMap ultra-wide field image. You can see just how much more of the retina is visualized in one shot with the optose ultra-wide field compared to the traditional seven standard fields. When we think about ultra-wide field imaging, we have to think about both the lens mirror distortion as well as the projection nonlinearity. Both of these become relevant. Lens mirror includes barrel or pincushion distortion. Many of us are familiar with this with the panoramic view and the wide field view on our cameras. The Mercator projection becomes important as certain areas on the retina may be overrepresented, just like certain areas on a spherical map are overrepresented when we put it on a flat sheet of paper. Greenland is the best example. We think of Greenland as being bigger than the United States when drawn on a map, when in fact, it's about one-third the size. Accurate measurements on ultra-wide field imaging is possible with optose software. When you correct for spherical bias, it enables one to accurately measure across the image, whether it's the posterior pole or the far periphery. This accurate measurement is necessary in order to clinically assess the size of a lesion, here showing a melanoma, and also to assess any possible progression over time. Measuring the area of the peripheral ischemia is also important. An optose advance enables accurate measuring of large areas throughout the retina with auto summation of these areas. This feature is being used in multiple pharmaceutical studies to measure disease progression or Part 2, comparison of widely used ultra-wide field imaging systems. Several years back, my group looked at two of the available ultra-wide-field systems at the time, the Heidelberg Spectralis non-contact ultra-wide-field module, and compared it directly to the Optos Optomap. Here, I'm showing two overlays of fluorescein angiograms showing that considerably more area of the retina is imaged in a single shot with the Optos compared to the Heidelberg Spectralis. Using similar imaging with a model eye, you can see the area of retina imaged in the red with the Heidelberg compared with the area imaged in the green with the Optos Optomap. This can be clinically relevant, especially when looking for lesions that you don't know the location of. Here's a patient that we included in the study with von Hippel-Lindau syndrome who is coming in for the first time for retinal screening. You can see the fluorescein angiogram from the Heidelberg that shows relatively normal retina. However, when the patient is imaged with the Optos ultra-wide field imaging, you can see the two retinal angiomas that light up. Here, the clinical relevance of imaging more of the retina becomes obvious. More recently, Chen and colleagues looked at a newer ultra-wide-field device, the Zeiss camera. When comparing the Zeiss wide-field camera to the Optos ultra-wide-field camera, a similar conclusion was drawn. The Optos captures significantly more retinal area in all four quadrants compared with the Zeiss Clarus. There was no difference in patient or technician preference or image acquisition time between the two devices. Not only does the Optos capture the most area of the retina in a single shot, but it gives high quality images, especially in the latest generation of the Optomap. With the latest generation Optomap, there's improved clarity and quality of the entire image. The features such as lattice degeneration, vessels, exudate, and borders of lesions are more clearly visualized with the latest generation Optomap visualization. Switching gears now to multimodal imaging of diabetes using ultra-wide-field Optos. We all know the ravage that diabetes has taken throughout the world. This diabetic retinopathy is but one complication of patients with diabetes. 93 million people will suffer some sort of eye damage from diabetes, with 1 in 3 patients living with diabetes expecting to get some level of retinopathy. Unfortunately, traditional imaging of diabetic patients is cumbersome, not only for the patient, but also for the technician. Over the last 10 years, it's become evident that the classification of retinopathy, the pathophysiology of macular edema, the screening for diabetic retinopathy, as well as treatment and follow-up of the patients with retinopathy, is improved significantly and meaningfully when using ultra-wide-field multimodal imaging. Here are some conventional fluorescein in patients who have diabetes. Now compare this with ultra-wide-field imaging. Although some level of retinopathy was apparent in the conventional imaging, with ultra-wide-field imaging, the extent of disease, the need for treatment, and the importance of follow-up becomes much more evident. In fact, in many patients, nearly all the diabetic pathology lies outside the 7 standard fields. Oftentimes, the damage from diabetes becomes evident only with ultra-wide-field fluorescein angiography. When we think about screening for diabetic retinopathy, non-midriatic ultra-wide-field retinal imaging compares very favorably and is actually superior to the conventional 7 standard fields. It's easier to do, it's faster, and provides even more information than traditional imaging. You can see here the area of the retina that's imaged with the 7 standard fields compared with the Optos OptiMap. The extent of pathology is better imaged and it's imaged faster with one shot in a non-midriatic fashion using the Optos. When you look at a large screening network, what you see when using the Optos for screening of diabetic patients is that you reduce the number of ungradable eyes by 81%, you increase the identification of retinopathy by nearly twofold, and you identify peripheral lesions suggestive of more severe retinopathy in 10% of the patients. Importantly, when using ultra-wide-field Optos imaging to screen diabetic patients, you can even pick up pathology in the peripheral retina that's not evident with the 7 standard fields and may not be related to the retinopathy. Here you can see a retinal tear in this particular patient. When we think of screening for diabetic retinopathy, we think of screening in developing nations. When I think of screening, I think of screening on the Upper East Side of New York, where there too, we have a problem with patients coming in for their diabetic eye exams. When we looked at our population of patients, of the diabetic patients across the entire physician organization, fewer than 20% receive annual fundus exams. The traditional concept of healthcare delivery involves buildings to which patients come to see their doctors, to which patients come to get their surgeries. However, in the 21st century, healthcare delivery is the modern reincarnation of healthcare delivery systems involves a technology company model that includes not only patients coming to physical buildings, but also virtual visits and telehealth. This virtual visit telehealth is becoming more and more important, especially in this age of the pandemic. Given what we had seen with the lack of compliance for diabetic eye exams, at Weill Cornell, we set up a teleophthalmology program. The primary goal was to increase fundus evaluation. The requirements were to use the standard of care tool, that is the Optos OptiMap, to seamlessly integrate images that are taken throughout our healthcare system. When patients go to their primary care doctors, as part of their visit, they also get an OptiMap. This OptiMap is then uploaded into the same database that I use in my clinic. And I'm able to read these images almost in real time and recommend either follow-up in my clinic or follow-up with another image in 1 year. We have now screened over 1,000 diabetic patients across the primary care offices. Approximately 10% need additional evaluation. Of those 10%, we have over 95% compliance rate to come see us in our ophthalmology clinics. Interestingly, the most common reason that we ask patients to follow up has nothing to do with their diabetic retinopathy, but rather a new diagnosis of glaucoma. Why did I insist on using the Optos OptiMap as my screening tool? Well, it's been nearly 10 years since we first published our findings on ultra-wide-field imaging in diabetic patients. With ultra-wide-field imaging, you not only capture more of the retina, but you really get a better understanding of the disease burden. As I said previously, In many patients, most of the retinopathy lies outside of traditional imaging modalities. And it's not just that most patients have peripheral lesions, but in those patients who have predominantly peripheral diabetic lesions, the risk of progression to vision-threatening retinopathy is much greater than if patients have normal peripheral retinas. This is why it is important to include in a screening program the standard of care that is the same as I use in my own retina clinic. Interestingly, we and other groups have found a correlation with the area of ischemia found on ultra-wide-field fluorescein angiography and the presence of diabetic macular edema. Perhaps it's not a causation, but a correlation, and represents a level of disease burden in patients who have had diabetes affect their eyes. Ultra-wide field imaging is not only important in diagnosis, but it's also important in follow-up and education of a patient. Here's a patient who came to me with bilateral proliferative disease due to diabetic retinopathy. After 4 anti-VEGF injections, not only did the macular edema improve, but the peripheral ischemia, as well as the neovascularization, significantly improved. This patient not only saw the results within his vision, but also was able to show his family what the injections were doing. A little over 4 years ago, the DRCR Net embarked on a prospective trial, Protocol AA, to evaluate ultra-wide field imaging compared to 7 standard fields. The initial results of the DRCRNet Protocol AA were published 2 years ago. The objective of this manuscript was to compare the old gold standard of 7 standard fields to what has now become the new standard of ultra-wide field imaging. Just as several groups, including ours, have shown in the past, peripheral imaging of diabetic patients shows more retinal pathology due to the diabetic damage than traditional imaging modalities. In fact, in many patients, it's neovascularization that is missed. What is the conclusion of this particular initial manuscript? Well, ultra-wide field imaging is now justified and now has become the gold standard for patients with diabetic retinopathy. And that is because diabetic retinopathy identification is increased nearly twofold with ultra-wide field imaging. Acquisition time is significantly decreased, as is ungradable image. And even once the images are taken, evaluating those images at a reading center level is improved by 28% when you look at ultra-wide field imaging compared with the traditional 7 standard fields. Shifting gears away from diabetes to multimodal imaging of uveitis. Here's a patient I saw this week who was sent to me for hemorrhagic posterior vitreous detachment. She was healthy and saw a doctor for flashes and floaters in the left eye. You can see here in the color optomap and the autofluorescence that the retinas look okay. In the left eye, you can see some vitreous opacities that could be consistent with a hemorrhagic posterior vitreous detachment. When you look in the back of the eye, in fact, this is not a hemorrhagic posterior vitreous detachment, but rather a uveitis. Ultra-wide field multimodal imaging is essential for evaluating all posterior uveitis patients. Here, you can see with the fluorescein angiogram that this patient has bilateral vasculitis. You can also see on the fluorescein angiogram deep hypofluorescent lesions at the level of choroid. The ICG angiogram in both eyes also shows deep hypofluorescent lesions, some of which hyperfluoresce late in the frames. In this case, the workup revealed the patient to have a positive HLA-A29. All other workup was otherwise negative. The patient was diagnosed with birdshot, and I started treating her this past week. Ultra-wide-field multimodal imaging in uveitis demonstrates more retinal vascular pathology both in the periphery and the posterior pole compared with the traditional 9-field montage used by many uveitis specialists. When combined with color, fluorescein angiography altered management in nearly half of uveitis patients and more than half of vasculitis patients. When you look at fluorescein angiography using ultra-wide-field imaging, the additional information showed more peripheral vascular leakage in a quarter of the patients, peripheral non-perfusion in nearly 15%, and peripheral lesions in 6.5%. Peripheral neovascularization on ultra-wide-field imaging was present in almost 4% of patients. In addition to evaluating the choroid, the retina, and the vessels within the retina, ultra-wide-field optomap color imaging has been validated to accurately assess vitreous haze in uveitis patients. I could not imagine taking care of uveitis, especially posterior uveitis patients, without multimodal ultra-wide-field imaging with the optos. Shifting gears once more to multimodal ultra-wide-field imaging of retinal tears and detachments. Here's a 41-year-old myopic patient who came to me with flashes on sudden eye movement. You can see in the infratemporal quadrant two retinal tears. These retinal tears are easily identified on the optos optomap. The question is what to do with these tears. Is there any traction? Using multimodal ultra-wide-field imaging, this time combining the optos optomap with the ultra-wide-field swept source OCT, what we find is no traction on the larger tear inferiorly. In contrast, the smaller tear, more supratemporally, has extensive traction and is the likely cause of this patient's symptoms. We lasered the tear with the traction after multimodal ultra-wide-field imaging using the optos. Here is another patient who presented for dilated exam as part of a routine visit with me. She's never had a dilated exam and never had any laser done on either eye. You can see in the left eye, there appears to be a retinal hole with some pigmentation. The question here is, does this hole require additional laser? Is there any traction around this retinal hole? Using multimodal ultra-wide-field imaging, what we determined is that there is no traction around the hole. In fact, the patient's own body has already scarred the retinal hole down. No additional laser or cryotherapy was necessary in this patient. Ultra-wide-field imaging of peripheral holes, tears, and detachment is essential, especially ultra-wide-field multimodal imaging. Ultra-wide-field-based imaging demonstrated sensitivity of nearly 90% in detecting peripheral retinal lesions compared with an exam that included depression. Ultra-wide-field imaging and dilated fundus exam did not differ significantly in the detection of peripheral retinal tears. And importantly, the extent of retinal detachment was consistent with intraoperative findings. Here's my last case. Here's a 24-year-old patient who came to me for second opinion, who was diagnosed with retinaschisis as a cause of decreasing vision in the left eye. You can see that there is, in fact, some cystic retinal changes in the posterior pole of this patient. Looking inferiorly, you can see an elevated retina. Using multimodal imaging, specifically the Optos Optimap and a swept-sourced OCT, what we were able to determine is that this patient had these cystic retinal changes because she had a chronic retinal detachment. There was no schisis as such, and it was one retinal hole that was easily imaged once we found it on the Optos Optimap. The swept-sourced OCT shows the retinal hole. We came up with a surgical plan. In this case, it was a scleral buckle. Six months following successful scleral buckling surgery, you can still see the demarcation lines in this patient with the chronic retinal detachment, but there's no signs of schisis at all once that retinal hole was closed. And in fact, the patient's vision returned to 20/20, and all of the fluid, subretinal and intraretinal, was reabsorbed in the posterior pole. Multimodal ultra-wide-field imaging is essential and is the gold standard for evaluation of retinal pathologies, from diabetes to uveitis to macular degeneration and also to retinal detachment. Thank you for your attention.